Dr. Wojcik, Mr. O'Brien. Roll call, please, Mr. Tevis.
Dr. Cordalino.
Here.
Mr. Graff.
Here.
Mr. Johnson.
Here.
Dr. Kane.
Here.
Dr. Wojcik.
Here.
Mr. Morell. Mrs. Nogan.
Here.
Mr. O'Brien.
Here.
Mr. Palmer.
Here.
Diane Amir, I'm sorry.
Here.
And Jonathan Graff.
He's not here, but he was standing there.
Former president.
Please rise for the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Tevis, the reading of the New Jersey Open Public Meeting Law Statement.
The New Jersey Open Public Meeting Law was enacted to ensure the right of the public to advance notice and to attend the meetings of public bodies in which any business affecting their interest is discussed or acted upon. In accordance with the provisions of the Act, Montville Township Board of Education approved this meeting date. Notice of the meetings have been posted at the Montville Municipal Building, while Montville Public Schools, Montville Public Library, Montville Township Board of Education Administrative Office Building, and Montville Public School website, and advertised in the daily.
And the high school representatives report, can I just say, it used to be that everyone would come in with typewritten pages or handwritten pages, now everything's on the iPhone, huh? Changing times.
The football team plays its next game at West Milford this Friday, September 23rd, poised for a win after two disappointing losses against Vernon on the 9th and Sparta on the 16th. The boys' cross-country team placed an impressive third as a team at their first meet on Friday the 9th at Randolph Invitational. Three boys placed in the top 20, Jonathan Kraft, Doug Gligorski, and Charlie Roy. The girls' team also placed fourth as a team with medals from Anna George, Jamie Whitner, and Cassie Gligorski. The girls' varsity field hockey team won 2-1 in sudden death overtime versus Roxbury. Junior Angelina Abbott had an amazing game on defense, and junior Brooke Radcliffe scored the game-winning goal. The next game is Monday the 19th at home against Mount Olive. There were some very impressive performances by the MTHS Frontiers team at their first tournament at Yale University last weekend.
Last weekend, the high school was Spirit Week, and it was a very exciting week for all the students to show their spirit by dressing up for the day's theme. On Friday, the students and faculty held a prep rally to celebrate the achievements of the ball sports teams and to give the football team confidence before the first game against Sparta. Each grade competed in challenges, with the senior class winning several and the junior class winning the co-voted tug-of-war. Two seniors, Srinatha Hovind and Priscilla Kim, were recognized as National Merit Scholarship semifinalists for their performances on the PSAT. The high school's back-to-school night will occur tomorrow on Wednesday, the 21st of September, and hopefully will go as smoothly as the elementary schools and the Lazars back-to-school nights that were held last week on Wednesday and Thursday, respectively.
Thank you very much. Any board comments, questions?
I don't know if any of the board members were able to attend the pep rally or anyone in the audience, but we did get a report from Dr. Rokhtar, and she said it was fabulous. And so it's just great to hear that you guys had such a good time. And we noticed on the agenda tonight there's a paint night fundraiser in October. That just sounds like a great way for you guys to develop some class spirit. So I hope you have a great year. Thank sounds you. Like it's off to a good start.
Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Rovtar, superintendent's report.
Just a couple of notes on the agenda. The first one, K-5. We have there the approval of a contract with a consultant to conduct an evaluation of our special services operations. And this is tied into one of our district goals for the year. And I just want to comment on the fact that this is not done because we believe that we have any specific problems or issues with our special ed operations. It's really from the perspective of trying to have a third party look at how we do things to determine if there are some recommendations in terms of efficiencies that might improve. you know, it is obviously a significant segment of our operation and our budget, and, you know, that's why we love to have, you know, an outside perspective in terms of how we're doing things. There is one correction that needs to be made to item, it's L.3.18, the termination date in that particular item should be 11/18/2016 rather than 2017. So if you can make that correction, we'll make sure that it gets corrected for the minutes. Okay, and this evening I am very excited to introduce Dr. Richard Ripp from Statistical Forecasting. Dr. Ripp has prepared a 5-year demographic study for the district, and I will turn things over to him. He will kind of walk us through the data, and then we will certainly have an opportunity for board members to pose any questions that they might have for Dr. Ripp.
So, Dr. Wiltar, this evening we're going to be presented, and it will be a public presentation, obviously, of this information. Do you have a plan that you're thinking of in terms of this evening we'll go over everything and we'll hear the presentation? Are we going to be making decisions this evening?
No. This evening is really to kind of put the data out there for everyone to have an opportunity to see it. This is also tied into one of our district goals this year, and following tonight's presentation, I'll be reaching out to convene a demographic study task force. I will certainly be looking for a couple of board representatives to serve in that capacity, some parent representatives and others from, you know, our own employees. With the purpose of really taking a hard look and analyzing that data and making some recommendations in terms of some of the issues that we have, the board talked about this when we did our goal setting, trying to balance our enrollment at the elementary level and trying to maintain the breadth of program that we have at the middle and high school level. So I think the data that we have in the report will be very important for that committee as they go about their work. So, in a very long way of answering your question, tonight is really, if you have some points of clarification or some questions, but you know, we're not making any decisions, we're not coming to any conclusions tonight in terms of what the data might tell us.
Thank you,
Dr. Wiltar. Everybody hear me? This is a little short.
No.
How's that?
A little better?
Great. Okay, so this study was prepared for the district back in April. So this is the culmination of that study. So 5 months later, I get the opportunity to see you and to present the findings. It'll probably take about 20 minutes. So if you won't mind just waiting to the end to ask any questions, I'd appreciate that. So very briefly, the firm that did this is my firm called Statistical Forecasting, which predominantly does school demographic work. It's a niche field, school demography. It really, there's not too many people in the state that do it. There's probably about 6 to 7 that I know of. About countrywide, there's probably about 100 of us. There's not too many in the field of demography. And most of the work is done in this area, but there are some districts that I work for, say in Arlington, Virginia, out of this area. And our company has been the chief demographic consultant for the New York City Public Schools for the last 10 years, working on a litany of issues, as you can imagine, with a school which is the largest in the country. So I'm the executive director. I have a doctorate in educational statistics and measurement from Rutgers. Most of us that wind up getting that type of degree wind up working for the College Board and working on psychometric issues related to validity and reliability of tests. I went to a little bit more of a practical method in looking at school demographics. And I presented numerous publications nationally and written papers and journal articles and things like that, testified in court. But besides all that stuff, I've actually had started my career in public education right here. 23 years ago, I taught at Montville High School in physics. And I thought I was a physics and statistics teacher for about 10 years before moving into a consultant role. So interesting to be back after all these years. So what's the purpose of the study? Many people think of a demographic study as one thing only. And that says, tell me how many students that we're going to have over the next 5 years. But in reality, there's many more facets to the study that we'd like to look at. But as you can see up there, the main purpose of the study is to project enrollments for the next 5 years. And many people ask, why don't we project further? Why can't you project out 10, 15 years? Well, the problem we really start to have is that kids who we want to project further out, say in year 6 or year 7, have not even been born yet. So it becomes really difficult trying to project future birth rates. What are the things that were looked at here were the HIP district's historical enrollments for the last 10 years, the community's birth and fertility rates, because that helps drive your kindergarten counts 5 years later, the community population trends and trends in age structure, impact of new developments on enrollment, and something called GIS mapping, which is where we take your student address database, bring it into a map format to see where students live, and look at it over a five-year period to see if there's changes in where people live over time. So looking at this graph here, this is Montville over the last 70 years or so, going back to 1940. So everything left of the vertical line is the population from the U.S. Census Bureau. Everything to the right is not projected by me, but projected by another agency called the North Jersey Transportation Planning Authority. And they project the populations for just about everybody north of Princeton and for the next 25 years. So what's interesting for your community is there was this real big growth in the 1990s. We're going to talk about that later on. There was a housing boom here. There was about a 33% gain in your population in the 90s causing a boom, as you probably recall, in the school system for those people who have been on the board long enough or even had kids in the school. But as you can see, most recently in 2010, the population here is really flattened out. And we're expecting that to continue into the future. A lot of it due to the fact that if you are part of the Highlands Preservation Area, development is being limited in the future, and the North Jersey Transportation Planning Authority does not think you're going to grow that rapidly, maybe 23,000 people next by 2040. So after we look at the key as a demographer, we don't just look at the school. We have to start with the community. So if you look at this, what I'm doing, I'm starting at the macro level. I'm looking at the community, and we're going to drill down into the school district level. And so that's all this information you see over to my left over here. It is just information about the town. So in the last 10 years, it became more Asian, actually. It was a drop off in the white population from 85 to 78%. Asians are the second largest racial group within Montville Township, 4.2% Hispanic, which is not very high. The median age here is high, which is 43. And that's going to be part of the issues that we're going to be talking about later, why your enrollment has been declining. The population that's far more, about 20%, pretty close to state average. India is the largest source in 2010. China was the largest source back in 2000. This is a very, very highly educated community. I study a lot of school districts, work with more than 100, 150. Typically, the highest I see for a bachelor's degree or higher, which is that middle part right there, is about 70% in some communities in northern Bergen County. So 62%, very high. Median family income is also very high. And the state average is about 89,000. So you're about 40,000 over the state median. Almost 8,000 housing units here. The predominant type of housing unit is the single family home. 14% are renter occupied, and the median value of the owner occupied unit is about 564,000. Just to go back to statistics, the median is the midway point, 50% or above that value, 50% or below. It's not the average. So one of the things that I was tasked to do was to work with my GIS person in creating elementary attendance boundary zones based on information that you gave us, which is, if I live on such and such a street in Montville Township, which school do I go to of the five elementary schools? So when you see this community snapshot up here in the different colors, it represents the different elementary attendance area boundaries in Montville Township. So I'll let you just look at that for a moment, because one thing that's interesting is down at the, see if I get the pointer right, there, right there. So there's a little spot right there, a little blue, which is actually sending up here to Hilldale, even though it's surrounded by Woodlawn. If I'm not mistaken, I think it's a pretty large apartment complex or something of that nature. So just to let you know, that is not a mistake right there. So in terms of the district's historical enrollments, in 1516, this is again, the study was completed in April. So at that point in time, your October 15 counts, and that's what we always go by, the October 15 counts, not June 30th or something like that, was about 3,774 students will round up. But your total enrollment has declined for six consecutive years. And what we're going to look at is not so much the total enrollment patterns, but what's happening at the different elementary, middle, high school levels, because that tells you a lot what's going to happen in the future. Almost 408 students have been lost since 2006. And we use something called the cohort survival ratio method to project enrollments. It's not something that we make up in terms of, I made this methodology up. It's something that was created about 78 years ago. And it is the state-approved methodology to project enrollments. So here's just the graph showing exactly what I was saying a moment ago in terms of your total enrollments. Take a look over here. So right around the 2009-10 year, that was your highest in this graph. And it's been going straight down here to where we are. It's probably, of course, gone even down further for the 16-17. But what we want to look at is this enrollments by level. Because this is the graph that I always tell my clients as the window to the future graph. Because what happens is, if you start having increasing or decreasing enrollment trends at the lower levels, which are the elementary, well, you know what's going to happen. They're going to start moving through into the middle of high school. So if you see declining enrollment in elementary, well, that's what's going to happen. So what's interesting here is I just told you a moment ago that the enrollment has declined for six consecutive years of the 10-year pattern that I just showed you. But take a look at the elementary. Elementary is the top. Elementary has declined for that whole 10-year period. So what's going to happen going forward is those smaller counts are going to push through into the middle of high school. You haven't seen the effects completely yet. The high school is the one here in red. And you can see it's just started in the last couple of years to come down. And in the middle school level, not as much. Okay? I think in the high school level, there's some other issues going on where some students don't come to public school here and they go elsewhere. At least that's what I'm seeing in terms of my data. So what is the cohort survival ratio method? Really quick, just so no one gets glazed over in terms of what this is. Really what we're doing is we're calculating survival ratios. No one's dying here. It's just a progression ratio of students from one year to the next. So if I have 100 first graders, and the next year I have 95 second graders, the survival or progression ratio is 95 over 100 or 0.95. So when we see these ratios below one, we're losing students, and we're above one, we're gaining students. And we gain students, we're referring to that as really inward migration. You're getting people moving into the community. So what I found for your district, which is really interesting, is that you have incredibly strong inward migration patterns here for the children under five population, and upwards to about sixth grade. And then after that, it's going the other way. It's an outward migration. So there are 13 grade levels. If you count birth to kindergarten as progression, it's a 5-year progression, K to 1 all the way up to 11 to 12. 8 of the 13, the average ratios from the last 4 or 5 years were below 1, which is indicating some type of outward migration generally overall in the district. Not at all grade levels, like I just said, just some. So when we calculate these ratios, like I just mentioned, we don't do it just for one year, but we do it for several years because there could be an anomaly year because we're going to use those ratios to project your enrollment going forward. So it's typically used an average of the last 4 or 5 or 6 years to figure out what your future enrollment is going to be. And that's what the last statement is saying, that I'm using an average ratio to project future enrollments. The big problem that's happening in this district is a phenomenon called kindergarten replacement, which has happened for the last 8 years, and you have lost an average of 98 students in the last 5 years do this phenomenon. I'm going to say, well, what is it? Real simple. It's when the number of graduating 12th grade students is greater than the number of kindergarten students coming in the next year. So real simple, if you graduate 312 graders, just to keep things relatively equal in the district, you need 300 kindergarten kids coming in September. Well, you're not getting that. Okay? Your kindergarten counts aren't big enough to balance out what's leaving on the other end. And that's what's happened. Just look here in the 15-16 year, you lost 102 and a half kids. You had 308 and a half kids as a shared time student there somewhere. 12th graders leaving, replaced by 206 kindergarten students. So for a district, that's almost unsustainable to have that kind of a difference in the 12th and the kindergarten counts, because you need a significant inward migration then to balance it out. Okay, that's really what's happening. And look what's happened just in the last 5 years. That historical kindergarten replacement, they're roughly, like I said, that average in the last 5 years, about 98 students. So if you look way back in one of my first graphs, the decline in the district has really exacerbated in the last couple of years. Well, this is why. Okay. So statistically, I then started comparing your enrollment change, which is just simply how much you dropped from 1 year to the next, in this case, to kindergarten replacement. See how close the values are? So it's almost like the amount of change in your enrollment from 1 year to the next is related directly to the kindergarten replacement. In fact, the correlation between the two variables, even though it's such a small sample size, was about 0.94, which was interesting. So let's go a little further. I told you your kindergarten counts are not big enough. Why? Well, let's go back to thinking about where those kids are coming from. It usually has something to do with your birth rates. Well, births have really dropped. So you had 281 births in Montville in 2001, down to 173 in 2012. Now, at the time of the study, the most recent data I had from the State Department of Health was 2012. The state's a little bit behind in getting data. If you understand working with the state, that's some of the things we deal with. But that's the most recent data. So we do use the birth data to project kindergarten counts 5 years later. And we did this by elementary attendance area to see which pockets, which parts of your township were declining or growing, even, compared to others. Well, a couple of things we found out. Number one, your fertility rates are very low here compared to the county level and the state level. We found that the annual birth counts were the greatest in the Woodlawn attendance area. And the largest decline over that 11-year period that we're talking about up there happened in Cedar Hill area. So this chart shows you, interestingly enough, a comparison of the births right here in Montville, and then 5 years later, how many kindergarten students show up on your doorstep. So the survival ratio for those is simply 288 over 281, which gets you this value. So what's interesting is, if you follow this chart down to here, you drop down to 173 births, 162 births here, but you have seen a decline in the kindergarten population, but not as steep as in the birth drop. So what's going on? This is what's going on right here. What we're seeing here is that you're getting a significant number of parents from other communities moving in here because they want to go to school here. It's an excellent school district. They want to come here. So you're getting like a 25 to 30% bump up from your births with this underage population of kids being born somewhere else, moving in here to start kindergarten. And that's why those values are in red here, to show you that in the last 5 years that trend has started, which sort of corresponds also with the beginning of the recovery of the housing market. So this here, this first red one would be right around the 2011 year, where things just started to pick up. And that's my thinking of why these values have changed so significantly in the last 5 years. So that's just a picture of the births pictorially over the last 10 or 11 years, and you can see how it's declined. This is the births by elementary attendance zone. So this is hard for you probably to read the legend, but I can tell you that the darkest color red is where the greatest numbers are. This is in 2001, which is in Woodmont. And the lighter colors, blue is, we don't have blue in this one, which would be the lowest, but green is also a good range. But what's interesting, back in 2001, the zones in terms of number of births were fairly tight. In other words, there really wasn't much of a difference between Cedar Hill zone versus Woodlawn zone versus Valley View. But look what happens now in 2012. I use the same scale so that you can see the difference. So now you have below, under 40 bird counts in 2012 in all these northern regions in the township. The southern part, Woodlawn, has basically stayed the same in the number of birds. And if you go to the next picture, this is even more interesting. This shows you the change in the number of birds over that time frame. So the darker color purple is the biggest loss. The red is sort of a medium loss, and the yellow is more or less holding constant. So the further north you go in this community, the lower the birth rates have been occurring. And this is the total number of birds by elementary zone. So if we just aggregate them over that whole entire period, again, what we see here is that the Woodmont area down the bottom there has had the most, followed by the Hilldale region, just north of it. So as a demographer, we look at other things to find out what's causing some of these declines. It's sort of like peeling back an onion. And this is the age pyramid of Montville Township from 2000. The age pyramid is simply a picture of the percentage of females at different anales at five-year intervals for the age classes, under 5, 5 to 9, 10 to 14, so on and so forth. But what we like to find that's interesting about this is here. Okay, for males are red, orange, and females are green. You can see how there's a big missing pocket here of people in their 20s, early 30s, a lot of people in their 40s. Okay, when we advance this now to 2010, take a look what happens. You might expect those people advance in age to now their late 40s, maybe early 50s. So now your biggest grouping is up here. Okay, and again, a big missing hole right here. And I say that because that's what it's supposed to look like if you live in the state of New Jersey. And why is that hole there? Well, and I bet you know the answer to this. Home prices then? Use with a T. Taxes. Property taxes. High property tax and high home prices will prevent a lot of people in their early, mid-20s, 30s from moving into a community like this. So that kind of diagram, even though it's showing the state, I would say I would find that in a more diverse community, both socioeconomically and racially. Okay? Your community's district factor group, we don't use that anymore in the state, is I. Okay, that I worked in Guten Township, Mendham Borough, Washington Township. You go back to that picture, cross out your name, put Bears in there, see the same thing. So this is nothing unique to Montville Township. It's more or less the area that you live in terms of Morris County. But it's very interesting to me in terms of what's going on. So if you actually looked at the change in the percentage of males and females over that 10-year period, I just did this really quick to show you. Take a look at the losses of females. That's really the people we care about because they're the ones having kids. But take a look at how many we dropped in a 10-year period in their 30s. Most women are having kids in their 30s now. But even look at the 25 to 29 period, you're losing some as well. And a big gain, people in their 40s. Now, there was a gain in the 15 to 19 region over that time frame, which is high school and college age. And I'm not really sure what was going on there, but that's definitely could have been some of the gain that you experienced at the high school over that period of time. So I did contact the local planning department here in Montville to find out what's going on here in terms of residential construction that may impact the projections. It's very important to find that out. When I spoke to the person at the planning department, she said there were 66 single-family homes, 23 townhouses, and 11 apartment units, a total of 100 units that are either before the board, in the pipeline, under construction, some various stages of approval. That's not that much, by the way. Sections of the township, as I mentioned at the outset, are in the Highlands Preservation Area. That's going to limit future development. And there have been 86 COs issued in the last 5 years for new homes, which is very similar to what's projected in the next 5 years. So it's really not much of a difference in terms of residential, future residential growth for new construction as opposed to the last 5 years. And the potential out of those 100 units, we use some multipliers from the state level, roughly about 66 kids is what we would get. So as I mentioned before, there was a boom here in housing in the 1990s. and you can see over 2,000 units were built. Okay, and it really has dropped off since then. Home sales. The home sales was in the early 2000s almost near 400 sales per year, really plummeted in the housing and banking crisis, as you can see. It started to go up in the last 4 years, but we're not still anywhere near where we were in the early 2000s. But I still think that attributes to the inward migration of people I talked about in work community. So let's get to the point. Where are we looking at the next 5 years? So this chart shows your projections by configuration, elementary, middle, and high. And you can see that the projected decline is going to continue, which was pretty obvious in the middle of high school, which you can see from the first chart, one of the first charts tonight, that the elementary population has been declining, so that will carry through. But due to the declining birth rate, the elementary population is still projected to decline even with people moving in with kids from other communities. The total loss over that five-year period is 364 and a half kids. So you're thinking somewhere around 3,400 students at the end of the five-year period. Now, in my research, I've done a lot of research for enrollment trends, because people say to me, I don't understand this. I'm seeing my community's population grow. Why isn't the school system's population growing as well? Why are they doing different things? They're not locking step. Well, it's because there's different people that are growing in that segment of the population. It could be the people in their 50s and 60s that are moving in, that are causing that growth to occur in a township or a city. So I should keep that in mind going forward, that what I found is that it usually takes 15 years from a district to go from peak to trough, and then back to trough to peak again. So you're only in the first 6 years of the cycle. It would not surprise me if you were in a 12 to 15 year decline cycle before things turn around. And that's totally within what I'm saying right here, because you've already gone down 6 historically. I'm projecting another 5. That brings you to 11. And you would start to see stabilization of enrollments once you start to see this start to stabilize. Once that kindergarten replacement starts to stabilize and you have your elementary enrollment stable, that will then carry through the day and cause that trend to change. But I don't see that right now, at least in the next 5 years. Projected kindergarten replacement, again, going forward. It is a little less going forward in the 70s and 60s, but again, still in the negatives. So looking at it by school, we broke it down. Here's the actual enrollment of each school, elementary, so 5 elementaries, and then the projected count 5 years later. And as you can see, all but Woodlawn are projected to decline, with Cedar Hill having the largest decline of about 121 students. That's pretty significant. So then the last thing we do before I show you some pictures, and we're near the end, is show you what your capacity of each building is compared to your enrollment, actual, and then projected. I should tell you that a capacity figure is not a hard and fast number. It's something that can change by board policy, by either having more students in the classroom or less students in the classroom per teacher. There's another methodology that computes capacity based upon square footage allowances. So when you see these capacity numbers up here, when you see the capacity numbers, don't get fixated on these values. They're just rough estimates of what the building is being used in terms of your long-range facility plan, and I don't really know how long ago that was, so it could be used very differently today. But what's interesting is that at Cedar Hill and Hilldale right now, they're slightly over capacity. You have negative means that you have what's called unhoused students. Blue would mean that you have a surplus. You can see there's a gigantic surplus right here, 273 seats at the high school. And as you might imagine, with declining enrollment projected, a lot of the reds are going to go away and turn into blues, except for a Hilldale, which is really, to me, just right, just the capacity. So the last thing, as I mentioned in the beginning, what we did is taking a look at your students and bringing them into a mapping software program, taking their address, putting them into a mapping. And this is just showing a point map of where they all live in the 15-16 year. There are some dots that are outside of Montville. It could be faculty members, students, or kids tuitioning in, or whatever. There's not many. But let's aggregate them by some kind of geography so you can see what's going on. This is the number of students that we aggregated by census block in the 11-12 years. Now, census block is a tiny, tiny small area designated by the U.S. Census. It's smaller than a census tract. It's much smaller than your elementary attendance boundaries. But what you can see here is the darker the color, the more students that you have per census block. So you can see things down here in the southern part of the township is where there's some dark pockets as well in the center. And let's see what happens 5 years later. I use the same scale again so you can see. But you can see it's, again, 15-16, really dark down here in the southern region of the township. And I'll just toggle back and forth so you can see the changes over time. Okay, so that's by census block. Now, for those of you that know anything about geography, not all the census blocks are the same size. So, of course, you might have the biggest number of students are going to be the biggest block. So we divide them by the square mileage, the area of each block, to kind of put them all on the same amount. So what you see here is the student density, or number of kids per square mile at the census block level. And the darkest color in purple is the highest density. Again, it's down in that apartment region right here. Okay, and reds are also fairly dense as well. Anything that there's no color, say up in here, very, very low density in those census blocks. Which again, remember I talked about the northern part of the township is very, very light in terms of students as well. And birds. So this is the picture from 15-16. Again, I'll just toggle back and forth. You can kind of see, for the most part, the densities have not changed significantly. Okay, and the last thing is we take a look at the student yields by zone, which is the number of kids per housing unit over time. So in the 11-12 year, we're looking at this by attendance zone. Blue is actually the lowest number. And that means that the Woodlawn area had the lowest number of children per housing unit. Okay, and I think it was around 0.4 children per home. That's an average based on people who do have kids and don't have kids. Red, which is not shown in this one, would be the highest. Actually, it is shown. You just can't see it. It's the little pocket in the apartment complex right there in the middle. You can't see it, but that is red. And so if we go to the next chart, you can see, again, there's really not too much of a change. Woodlawn has stayed the same, and they still have that red pocket down there, the apartment complex. So with that, I will stop talking, and I will turn it over to the board to ask me questions if you so desire.
Hi. Okay. Hi. My name is Mike Palm. I'm a board member. I have a few questions for you, Doctor.
Sure.
First of all, thank you for your excellent presentation. I know a lot of work went into it. Do your projection figures for the future, I won't ask the question that way, I'll ask it this way. In your projection for the future, which school are you assuming that the kids from Rachel Gardens are going to be going to from here on out?
Well, I'd assume that whatever they're going to currently, there was no change in terms of boundaries for this study. So wherever they're going currently is where you're talking about that little pocket down there in the bottom.
Well, okay. Here's the situation that we have the apartment complex of Rachel Gardens in the southern part of the Woodmont district where Hilldale is right now also, the little red thing. Now, historically, those students have kind of split between Woodmont and Hilldale. This year, because of the imbalance between the two schools, all the kindergartners from that area are going to Woodmont. So, in your projections for the future, are you assuming that all of the students are going to Woodmont as they are the new students this year, or are you assuming there's going to be a mix as there has been historically in the past?
Remember, this study was completed back in April, so the answer to your question would be the way it was back then, which would have mixed.
Okay, so then if all the students from the apartments went to Woodmont in the future, then obviously Woodmont's numbers would significantly increase, correct?
Right.
capacity. How do you calculate the capacity per school? And is there any consideration for needed use for special things such as art, music, computer labs, things like that?
Well, first of all, the question, who develops these capacities numbers? This is actually based probably from your architect. I don't know who exactly your architectural firm is and when they did the last long-range facility plan, but I did not generate these numbers. I actually took them from your long-range facility plan. And they do take into consideration, I do know enough about it to tell you that there is special considerations for art, music, special ed, things of those nature.
Okay, but for example, if the architect had said that a certain school should have an art room, and the school, because of overcrowding, has now taken that art room and converted it into a classroom, that's...
Then change the capacity numbers that you see. That's what I said. I don't know how long it's been since you had an architect walk through the building and see how you're using it, because these capacity numbers can change very drastically if you're using it very differently than, say, 5 years ago.
Also, last question. You said the Woodmont area, the number of births has been most consistent. Is that, do you believe, partially because the lower income people, the younger people tend to be in the apartments because they haven't maybe developed their careers as much as some of the older people? They start out in the apartments, so you have a younger demographic in there?
I really can't even speculate what's going on. I don't have enough information in the Woodmont area by age to tell you exactly what's going on. Because you gotta understand the way we're looking at this, we don't have census data by your elementary attendance area, so I really couldn't tell you.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Palmer asked one of the key
questions.
But let me just go back. And this is not disputing anything, I'm just trying to get a grip on it. When you did the decades building by decades, when you said that the 90s were the decade, does that look at the type of residence being built? In other words, that 2,024 units, couldn't that have been senior citizen unit? Do you look at that at all? You just look at starts or something?
Just starts, yeah. So they could be seniors, they could be multi-families. Absolutely, it's a mixed bag of everything. Okay.
Did you see any reflection, though, as a result of that boom in the numbers?
Well, I think when we saw there was a pretty significant increase in enrollment here, probably in the late 90s, in mid-90s, so that's where I'm seeing that growth. But obviously now we're declining, so that is coming up.
I wanted to ask you about the chart regarding, there are so many things that I'm losing where I am, the charts that show the age groupings. And for lack of a better, I guess you could say the top of the chart might be empty nesters, right? Is that a fair?
And I was wondering, empty nesters could be anywhere from 50 on up.
Yeah, here's what I'm wondering. In factoring this, was there any thought to? And again, this is impressionistic on my part, just impressionistic, not scientific or democratic. I see people, you know, in the community that, you know, like myself, they're over 39, and there's a lot of houses with just a couple in them now. And does your prediction take that into, could it be that in 5 years, all of a sudden, for whatever reasons, there's going to be a big turnover in those houses with 3 and 4 bedrooms?
No, you're asking a great question. I'm going to answer this in layers because there's a lot to it. To answer your question, it wouldn't happen based upon a lot of districts that I've worked for in one single year, two single years. It actually doesn't happen as much as you think. You're right to have, you have a lot of people in their 50s and 60s ready to downsize, move to North Carolina where it's cheaper down there. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't happen all at once. And the reason I can actually tell you that Your district didn't hire me to do this option. It's actually called a housing turnover analysis, where in certain communities, I will look at sales data for the last 30 years, 40 years, and then project going forward what a lot of that turnover is going to be in a community and how that would impact the district. But I will tell you that longer homes, or longer owned homes, 30, 40 years, people in the same home, my parents in the same home for credit for 52 years, there's, even though there's a large stock of them in a lot of communities, it's scary to look and see how many there are and think, wow, if they all go at once, we're going to have an influx of people moving in here with kids, but it doesn't happen.
It doesn't, yeah, I realize it wouldn't happen at once, but there are a lot of those.
Not even a couple of years.
Yeah, there are a lot of those, maybe not $1 million houses, but 4, 5, 6
Understood.
100. Okay, so we didn't ask you to do that portion, is what you're saying.
Correct.
Okay.
But I still don't think, based on just what I'm seeing in other districts, without even you getting a study, that piece done, I really don't think that would impact you, at least in the near term. You have other factors that are just too big here going on. It's
all right.
Driving home.
And the other thing was about capacity analysis. Mr. Coleman asked that already. I wondered about those numbers because of changes in education, which you're familiar with.
Yeah. Yeah, I would consider finding out when that last update plan was done. Dr. Ricard probably knows that.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
Well, thank you very much for the presentation. It's very interesting to look at these numbers, and I can get lost very easily in all of these numbers. Some of my colleagues have already mentioned some of the questions I had. Again, looking at that particular chart there, you do see a lot of people leaving as they get older. And so naturally, that is a big question for us. A lot of the homes here were built 30, 40 years ago, and we're expecting at least some turnover in those people.
And I think you are gaining, there's no question, you are gaining people due to inward migration in the home sales, and the fact that you are getting so many kids here that under age 5 that show up on your doorstep. So the question I guess you really want to ask is, could sales increase to maybe where they were 10, 12 years ago, and how would that impact the number of kids coming in? So that what it could do, if that theoretical question was asked and answered, would be that it would probably start increasing your kindergarten counts and start stemming, I'll say that word strongly, stemming the decline in the elementary population quicker than what it is now. I'm not saying you're not going to decline, it's just that instead of having maybe a 12-year overall decline, you might get it down to 10 or 9 or something like that.
Because it looks like from your home sales chart, you did have a peak back just before the recession.
Right.
And that peaked nearly at 400 home sales a year, but now it's coming back up to almost 300.
Right.
Which it looks to be something about what it was before the big housing rush and all of that. So I'm going to guess we're going to get back toward that, and we may even pick up a few. But it's also interesting that, as you mentioned, it's a good school district. People are moving in. We're getting a lot of young kids coming in with the families. And so when you mention that there are 100 units that are being constructed or in plans, and then you say only 66 kids, if you're talking about families moving into these homes, how do you get from 100 units down to 66 kids? Because my experience is not many couples move into these homes.
Sure, that's a good point. Well, again, it's not based on Montville averages, it's based on North Jersey averages. So if you look at the chart that I put back up there, the state average for a 4-plus bedroom home in a above median, which it is here, price range, is around 0.85 kids per home. So you take that and multiply that by 66, that gets you somewhere around 50. Then for townhouses, the yields are much, much smaller. They're somewhere in the range of 0.25 to 0.3 children per unit. And for apartments, depending upon if they're market rate or affordable, it can determine how much it is. It could be around 0.2 to 0.3 as well.
Do you have any idea if that's holding true for Montville?
I'd have to, no. The only way we'd have to do is find comparable
units. Mayor, Mr. Mayor, do you happen to know if that's true?
No,
you want to know? Okay. Okay, and then my last question would be, according to what you said, you're going to then estimate that our population will be near the bottom in what, mid-2020s, 2025, something like that. That's when we should expect some kind of nadir.
I'm just saying that based on averages, this was the state average that I looked at in the 70s when there was a booming period, and it bottomed out in the 90s, so on and so forth. It was like a roller coaster. I should put that picture up here. I would just say that, let's go back. Okay, so there's where you've been. I would say, I mean, again, just based on averages, you could be talking about your nadir somewhere in the 2025.
And to be honest, I'm glad you put the graph like that. So many people would put the bottom of the y-axis at like 3,000 and make this look like a huge drop. I despise when people...
I would get yelled at by my statistics.
I would too. I know that. I don't find that to be an honest
thing.
But it doesn't, I mean, there's really not a lot of change up there at the top when you really look at it. I mean,
well,
there is change, yes, but it's not like we're losing half our students.
Well, I mean, it's all relative. I mean, look, I want to play devil's advocate, and again, I'm not advocating for anything, but you lost 10% of your student population almost in the last 10 years. That's significant.
That's significant, but when we talk about it later, how that affects especially our elementary schools and number of kids per classroom, 10% is 2-3 kids per class. That's not a lot of kids out of each section of each grade. So that's why I mentioned that. And thank you very much.
Charlie?
Hi. Can you put up the chart with the elementary school projections?
By school? Sure.
I know with all of the work you've done, and I know of your reputation, even though you went to Rutgers, it's not all bad. But,
you a Penn State man?
Looking at that chart, I'm getting out of the total number of kids, 4,000 versus 4,100. And we only have one middle school, we only have one high school. So it boils down to the elementary. Now, as you look at that chart, what does that tell you in your vast experience with all of these demographic studies that you've done?
Now I'm asking you to give me a little more direct question. What is specifically...
well, if you're looking at the 2021 enrollment, and if you look at Woodmont School, everything seems to be decreasing, but Woodmont School is increasing.
Sure. Well, that makes sense to me, because if I went back to one of the diagrams that showed Woodmont's birth, there is a table in the report, not a picture. The Woodmont births have actually been fairly stable or maybe slightly increasing over time, whereas Cedar Hill has had just a plummeting drop-off. So it makes total sense to me if you just follow the births and see where they are by attendance zone, and that kind of translates to what's going on up here. Because they become kindergarten students, and of course they go further.
Well, I know this was the data from last April.
Right.
That you just moved everyone to all X number of spots. Okay? Looking at this chart again, it would appear to me that we have a problem at Woodmont, and that we have many more kids there than we have at the other schools from a change point of view.
Well, you're referring to probably this one, right? Capacity?
I'm not worried about the capacity. Capacity is your made-up numbers, as you said before. We can get any architect to come in and do capacity studies, right?
Well, to be honest with you...
So we're struggling with the elementaries, as you can gather. I know Dr. Rokar might have told you that. And we're looking at... There's two big areas. Let's put it on the table, Hilldale and Woodmont. Because they're, like, right at capacity. Excuse me, not capacity. They're right there this year. Forget about the capacity numbers. And moving it forward, it looks like it's only going to get worse. Is that an observation? Is that in?
Well, if you look up here, Woodmont looks like it's going to be going up, correct, but I am projecting a slight decline in Hilldale.
So
that should help some of the issues there.
Mm-hmm. And that's projecting everybody as of last April.
Correct.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sure.
Yes, sir. So just to be clear, your generalization prediction, your thought on this, I'm not trying to put words, is that there's approximately a 12-year cycle, but maybe a 10-year cycle. Does your information tell you if we went through such a cycle previously, or has Montville, does your look at this go back then?
No, I only went back to 2006. The data that I can get actually from the state is up to 1998. But if the district's willing, if you have that in your paper repository someplace, and we could easily take a look at that. But I'd be interested in seeing what kind of long-term trends, but I don't have
it. I actually looked at this a couple years ago.
Jim, could you move forward?
I have the old ASSA state reports, and they go back quite a ways. And I did notice a trend where it was about 10 or 11 years where it was a decline.
And so we came out of that?
And then we came out of it, and we were going in 2006, and now we're declining.
And it was about 10 or 11 years?
About 10 or 11 years.
And that's the total school district?
Yes, sir. I was looking at the total.
So that was the
end by the school, it's just before we go.
So before we start rising up out of that, our elementary schools are actually going to start increasing numbers before the district as a whole comes out. Because if we're still decreasing, if that bubble or that depression is moving through, it's hitting the high school as the next wave starts building behind at the elementary schools.
Typically, yes.
Yeah.
Trough, which you seem to notice, would that correspond with selling off possibly of three schools?
I was just looking at the raw numbers from our ASSA state report.
We actually had a lot more capacity, maybe not in terms of how it's used, but in square footage at one point in time.
Could I
help you with that one? Just my research, if we overlaid your enrollment growth patterns with that of the state, it'd almost be pretty close. I don't think it's locally driven. I think it has a lot to do with the baby boom, the baby bust. If you follow those patterns of people and the kids of the baby boomers and now the grandkids of the baby boomers, that's what's driving this whole thing.
And did the other districts possibly sell off, some of those districts sell off schools or at that time? Or?
I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know if they sold stuff off, but I'm just telling you in terms of what trends you're seeing, I don't think it's driven by whether people are selling schools off. It's really this birth pattern.
Yeah, well, we did close three schools over the years.
I think a lot of districts, and Morris County went through that in the 80s, towards the end of mid to late 80s, where they had excess capacity, they converted buildings, they sold buildings. I think that was very prevalent.
That's right. I worked with Dr. Rokar at Long Hill, and you had some declining enrollment in your district and your as well. So if you look around your neighbors here, like I said, they're not.
Well, it was mostly aging buildings. I mean, they were the aging buildings.
Right.
Okay, I'm sure other districts.
Any other board member?
Yes,
comments, Michael?
I do. I have a question that's kind of, I guess, going to bounce back and forth between the superintendent and the expert. We have the projected numbers for 2016-17. Now, here we are, September 2016. We should probably know what the actual numbers are.
Which I provided to the board on Monday. And amazingly, Dr. Grip, I don't think I have those. I probably do have those in my pile somewhere. But you were almost spot on. I mean, in certain instances, it was right on the dot in terms of the enrollments, but I did provide that to the board on Monday.
The only reason I asked is because you said that you were assuming that the split between Woodmont and Hilldale for the Rachel's Garden students was going to be the same as it's been historically, correct?
Right.
So this 57 projection for Woodmont was based upon historically?
Right. So yeah, I didn't have any of that information out of that study, so yeah, there seems to be a conflict in.
Yeah.
Right. But Mike, I mean, there was only, I think, 8 kindergarten students that were enrolled at Woodmont that would have normally been at Hilldale. I don't know that that's a significant driver that would have altered the projection, so we're talking about...
I mean, that 57 would become a 65. I mean, do you happen to know what the numbers are for Woodmont Hilldale this year for kindergarten?
I gave all that to you, yes.
I don't remember, okay. If you don't remember off the top of your head, that's fine.
I don't have it with me tonight, but I did, at your request, provide that to you on Monday.
So I'll take over for a moment. First of all, Dr. Dick, I wanted to thank you very much. Very complete report, and appreciate your presentation. One of the things you talked about is people wanting to move into this community because of the excellence of the schools. I wanted to point to that, and I wanted to say that we hear that often. We know that. And the administration, the teachers, the employees of the district should be very proud when they hear a knowledgeable expert say what we already know. I did want to point to the boom of housing in the 1990s, because I think that is a very important point to your presentation. I'm not a historian, but I believe that that was when the 287 spur was completed, that connected Route 80 to Mahwah to northeastern New Jersey. And there was a lot of growth in these areas alongside of Route 287. I did have a question, if you happen to know, as an individual who not just has worked here in Montville Township, but understands what's going on in the state. There has been a slowdown in the economy in this state, whereas around 2000, things were churning very well. And from what I believe I've read, there has been a migration out of the state as opposed to into the state. And my question to you is, the demographics that you relate, is that part of a state trend? Is that something that is just solely Montville? Are I districts, I know you use that term loosely, and we understand that that's not something technically that's used anymore. Is it something that I districts like ours are experiencing, or is that a Northern Jersey phenomenon?
It's actually, from what my experience, the I and the J districts, which is the highest level, it's almost, they're a poster child for that picture up there, regardless of where they are in the state. But to be honest with you, most of the districts that I deal with, the I and J, really, once you drop past South Princeton, there's not too many of those. So it's more in the Bergen, the Morris counties, you know, in the northern part of the state. So I don't know if that's a geographic thing or not, but I just really, my hunch has just been doing this enough. It has a lot to do with real estate prices. And just getting in at that price point that a young person can afford.
Thank you.
It's just my opinion.
Other question, after this presentation this evening, will you be available to answer further questions?
Sure, Dr. Rokar can pass along any questions to me, email or phone, whatever works for you.
Were there any further questions? All right, thank you. I would like to, before you leave, I would like to open up to the public for any questions on this particular item. I would also, I feel remiss that I did not mention earlier that we're honored to have our Mayor Jim Sandham here this evening. Welcome, Mr. Mayor.
Just a couple of things I wanted to mention to the board. When I sat on this Board of Education in 2001 to 2003, we had demographic study as well. And it said the bubble in the school system would happen between 2008 to 2010, and it came true. So I placed a lot of emphasis on these studies. There was limited building in 2000, happening 2015, roughly. But I will also tell you, and you probably doesn't have this information, there are two significant potential developments to happen in town. And both of them are exactly where you don't want them, unfortunately. One is the old GI Auto property that has a potential application for apartment complex with upwards of 300 units.
Where is that?
GI Auto.
Oh, GI.
Down at the southern tip of the town, the southeastern tip of the town,
300
to 300. Now we, the township committee, prefers not to have rental units. We prefer to be home, be simple condominiums, townhouses, which would have a different impact. You should be aware that there's development pressure there. There's also development pressure at the old Bayer complex, where a developer wants to put in a mixed use of commercial and residential there that could have upwards of 100 units as well. So just so you're aware that those development pressures are there. There aren't applications in yet on either of those, although we've seen potential plans. And so your demographer doesn't have that information. Anecdotally, I will tell you that we are seeing the 50 to 60 empty nesters starting to move out a little bit, and younger families moving in. Just in my neighborhood in the last couple of years, the two houses I turned over, one brought in two kids and one brought in three kids. So you're seeing that a little bit. And I do think that the millennials are also not buying houses to begin with, first of all. They're paying off college debt. And then after that, the price of housing in Montville is significantly higher than some surrounding communities. And you're seeing less of an input in the very young. I think the point that was made was that it was true, is you're seeing it come in somewhere in the grammar school years, in the elementary school years, whether they're 5, 6, 7, 8, they're moving in then because they've accumulated enough money. Maybe they've been in a starter home and flipped that one and have enough equity to be able to move in and afford a house in Montville. So that's just anecdotal stuff, but if you ask me a question, I'll give you that input that I have. And I really think that was it. So I thank you for your
Can you have a question from there?
Thank you for coming tonight. If you know, and I didn't expect you to know off the top of your head, the town was rezoned. There was some rezoning that went on a few years ago. There were some portions of the town.
There was a master plan.
The change in the master plan. Do you know if where GI Auto is and where Bayer is? Can we assume that those developers are going to need substantial zoning?
Changes, variances?
Variances, yes, thank you.
Okay.
Are they already zoned for the use that's
potentially
coming?
They are zoned for potential residential already. They may not be zoned for apartments. I can't tell you off the back of my, top of my head. But they have residential potential.
Okay.
They may be single family residential as opposed to apartments or townhouses, but and it's funny, but the developer, one of the potential developers for the GI Auto property, is using COLA as a reason to put in apartments down there. The township needs more affordable housing units in town, and that's the reason to put in apartments versus a fee simple situation. So that may end up in what somewhere. So those developments are potentials. They're not tomorrow. They're, in my mind, 3 to 5 years, 7 years down the road, depending upon
just one other thing too. We hear a lot about the empty nesters moving out of town. It's not necessarily happening. Maybe moving from one part of town to another part of town, but they're not moving out. Like today, I saw a friend who moved out of Manchester, and he moved up into Companion. So they want to stay in the community because their kids are close. But I don't think we're getting the numbers moving out like other communities may have.
That may be true too.
And their properties, for the most part, are very saleable because they're in that medium range, which would help the people in the 30s and 40s, well, 25, 30, 40, to bring their families in. However, they're still in town. And I'm happy they're here because they like the community. Same as Matt said before, we get a lot of people to move into town because of the schools. They may not be born in town, but they move in, and I think that's a great sign.
One other thing I will mention is the developments that will happen will probably, in all likelihood, not have age-restricted senior housing. The marketplace in Morris County is pretty saturated with that kind of right now. In fact, at one point we had a senior development potential for the GI Auto property and fell apart because the economies for that kind of housing fell apart. So if those things go through, you're probably going to get some school-age kids.
But that's down the line, Jerry.
Yes, I understand. Okay, thank you.
Thank you for your comments, and thank you for being here, Mayor Santa.
By the February-March timeframe, so that it can be reflected in any decisions that need to be made with regard to enrollment for 17-18. So, no, this is not a two-year process, no.
And now, would this affect children who are going to certain schools? Like, could they possibly have to be redistricted and go, say, from fifth grade to
I can't answer those questions. I mean, that will come out of the discussions that the task force will have.
Any other questions about this particular item from the public? All right, thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Gray.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your very insightful questions. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Feel free to stay.
All right, moving along with the agenda. Business administrator, Jen, do you have anything?
Just real quick, can we report that the financial audit is ongoing in the business office? The auditor at this point completed with their actual field work in the office and begun working on the actual funding themselves.
We're still aiming for October 2018 on that audit. I know that's a lot of shit.
I'm sorry.
You're still shooting for the October 16th or 18th meeting, whenever?
No. I mean, November.
Yeah, I mean,
the one
that's on December 1st.
Yeah, well, I know, but it's still last year. I know we had to wait for the state.
Yes.
And I thought we were going to try and move that ahead. And Rob, I thought was going to finish his work in October to come to the finance meeting.
Yeah, I had taken, I can check my notes, Mr. Grau. I thought we, he had said November.
Yeah, so it'll be presented by the November meeting.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Any committee reports?
Facilities committee will be meeting on October 5th at 5 p.m. in the board office. All of the information will be disseminated ahead of time to give us time to look at it.
Very well. Any other committee reports? Ad hoc delegate liaisons.
What about PTA? I believe it's September 28th.
September 28th.
I just wanted to update the board on the Morris County School Board's meeting, September 28th. It's the first meeting of the school year. The topic is school funding, where we are and how we got there. Denville is going to be presenting a good news and sharing segment of that meeting. They're going to be doing their middle school advanced and online classes. We all received in our packets notification that our own Marissa Castronova and Jen Columbi from Riverdale are recipients of the NJEA Frederick L. Hip Award. And I am pleased to say that both Jess and Marissa have volunteered to do the good news and sharing of their program at the November 9th meeting. So lots of good stuff to look for. Cedar Hill is having their first PTC home and school meeting tomorrow, and I'll be attending at 9 o'clock.
Very well. Mr. O'Brien.
I have a couple reports, but I'm going to sort of do them in a reverse order, if that's okay. Two of them are sort of off the agenda, so I'll be very quick. One, Montville, met this morning. They had a meeting this morning, and just so everyone here is aware of it, One Montville will be having a booth at the Chihuahua Fest, which is on the first And that was one of the things we were working on today. And most of the people were working on plans going ahead for programs and fundraisers and so on. The next meeting of One Montville, I'm sure anybody can go to it, is free that day, is on October 11th. It's a daytime meeting. So if anybody wants to help out, you know, with One Montville, or help out with the booth on the first, you can certainly contact me. It was interesting, there are a number of student leaders now who are at the meeting today, and they have created a culture club in high school, which is taking the lead on this program. I was very pleased to see this, that this is moving forward with students as the movers in this situation. Okay, so again, that's going to be, I just gave you the date of this program. On the 11th, October 11th, is the next meeting. Now, I know this isn't on there, but I just wanted to mention the Hall of Fame met this week also one night, and the Hall of Fame is looking for volunteers to be on the Hall of Fame committee. The next Hall of Fame induction dinner will be in November 17th, a year from now. Okay. So in that year, they're going to make selections, and they're looking for nominations, and they're looking for people to serve on the nominations, the full committee. Okay, our numbers are somewhat down over the years. And it's all evening meetings. And in conjunction with that, an interesting thing came up. In November, this November now, because the Hall of Fame induction will be a year November. But there's an interesting thing happening. It's the weekend before Thanksgiving. Two of the classes from Montville are having their reunions on the same evening this year. The 30th reunion of every year that you figured out. And the 40th reunion on the same night. One is at the Regency in Wayne, and one is at the Villa in Mountain Lake. So if you people are interested in things like that, you know, if you've had any people that go back for 30 and 40 years, they're fascinating. But I mean, they really are. You walk in there and you see people and you can remember faces, and they're great experiences. Okay? So that's the weekend of Thanksgiving, Regency and the Villa. Okay? And I think it's important, not to get particular, if you just want to stop in and see some of these people from years ago. Okay, so that's the whole thing. All right. Now, I have to apologize. The high school PTC meeting, which I was supposed to attend, I got there late. As a result, I learned a rule from the principal, and he said, keep the simple rule in mind. Everything starts at 7 o'clock at the high school. Football, PTC, Mustangs, whatever it is. And I had to apologize, so I don't have much of a report for that. Okay, my fourth and last report is the Mustangs. Okay, now I did go to the Mustang meeting on the 7th. It was the most well-attended meeting that I had seen in a couple of years. Right? And a lot of parents there, the athletic director, of course, the principal were there, and myself, and there was a lot of input. It seemed like a lot of new people, parents that want to be involved in the Mustang Association. And just to reiterate, the Mustangs, so everybody knows, it's not just about sports. You know, they support everything in high school. And it was interesting, they did bring up, the athletic director brought up, that there's over 400 students out for fall sports in high school. It's a really, really great number to see that many students. That's all the levels and all the sports for the fall. And the principal spoke for some length of time about the programs that they're having at the high school, at least mentioned earlier, pep rally and so on, to try to bring the student body together and to try to reinstill the spirit. And I think if any of you went to a football game on Friday night, you've seen that. The kids were there really pumped up in groups. I don't know if you saw the blackout and everything like that. So that was what I would do before the Olympics.
Mike.
They had that big barbecue in the high school parking lot. It was really something to see, the enthusiasm that was there. And the Mustangs are behind this, of course, the administration, and they're trying to foster and support that building of school spirit and building of the spirit for the student body. And they talk about, with the administration, some of the positive things, you know, that they're trying to do. But one of the things that came up and was talked about at length, this was a pretty long meeting, was the topic of admissions at football games, the admission football games. Now, I don't know if the numbers are correct and so on, but according to the members of the board, I won't mention names, but they seem to be pretty much all on the same page. A meeting took place with some members of the Mustang board and some members of the administration regarding suggestions about admissions at sporting events, but particularly football. And it appeared that the Mustang board leadership had some suggestions to make about how to increase attendance through, and they gave various positions that suggestions that they made in that meeting. And the impression I got, and this is why I didn't write a written report this time, I just wanted to speak to this, was that they're trying very hard. These people are volunteer people working to support the programs in high school, sports, music, everything. And there seemed to be a little fresh disappointment that they didn't get a little further on some of the suggestions that didn't seem to me like very difficult suggestions. Now, I'm not saying that everybody should be admitted free to, you know, all sporting events, although am I correct, they don't charge now for basketball and wrestling?
Yeah, that's right.
But a suggestion like possibly having, you know, a towel night, you get the free towel, and some people get it. But the suggestion was that towel gets you into the next game, for example, for free. Okay, that didn't seem to me like that was a sort of a fallback suggestion. So I'm just saying that I perceive that there's some disappointment, possibly, that more things couldn't be worked out regarding their efforts to push school spirit and the involvement of students. Okay, so I wanted to convey that to you, the sincerity and the concern and possible disappointment that some of the people in the room felt regarding that topic. Okay. So that I would say that issue of school spirit and student involvement really took up most of the meeting, and there was a lot of input from members of the community, some who were there on a regular basis, and a lot of new people regarding the efforts of the Mustang Association, in the hope that maybe they'll get a little more work together with the administration on some of these things. I don't mean necessarily high school administration, just the administration. Okay. One more thing I just want to mention, an interesting thing that they're moving forward with this year is more involvement of the alumni in some events. For example, the wrestling this year is going to have a wrestling alumni. Now, you know, years ago we had some really top rate wrestlers, state championship wrestlers, from Montville Township. We've been up and down, but we've had some really state champions. So they're trying to get like a wrestling alumni night event, okay? And No, it might be interesting if that works out, that they move forward with some of these events for either basketball or for, you know, whatever sports that, you know, held in the building, you know, or maybe even for football, an alumni event. In fact, some famous football players. Some really, a lot of players that went on to play in college and different places and so on. So they're working on those kinds of things. The efforts, a lot of effort, the Mustangs put a lot of effort into the things that they do. And it's really worth, if anybody wants to attend, to be at a Mustang meeting. If you just, you know, want to show up, it's the first Wednesday of every month. Okay. So that's all I want to say. And I want to apologize again for being late to the PTC meeting.
Thank you, Mike. Any other PTC liaison?
Go ahead. Mike, when did you say the curriculum committee meeting?
I didn't say curriculum committee. I said I wouldn't have the PTC.
I apologize.
I don't think we have a curriculum, do we, Andrea?
No, we have to set one.
I heard the 28th, and I know that's the night of the school board.
Additional reports. Public participation for items that are on the agenda only. Seeing as there is none, I'd like a motion for approval of recommendations.
Second.
Items I through O. Thank you. Minutes, item I, any?
The addendum
revision as well. Thank you, Ms. Peebles. Yes. I, minutes, any board comments, questions? J, administrator. Comments, questions? F, finance. Sorry, excuse me, I'm having trouble with the pages. JK. Item L. Item M. Just wanted to mention something. Item M41. There are so many parents that volunteer and help out with the school district, whether it's PTCs or Mustangs or, well, some of us are parents and volunteers as well. You know, it's just so wonderful to see the community involved and helping out. You sort of see certain names of individuals especially that are really always there and always doing things to help the district. Just wanted to make that comment. Item N, any board comments or questions? Item O. Roll call, please, Mr. Peters.
Mr. Grout.
Yes, on everything except M1, number 25, abstain.
Mr. Palmer.
Yes.
Dr. Corleone.
Yes, except abstain K1, check number 83321, and M.
Dot 1,
number
24. Mr. Johnson.
Yes.
Dr. Mudra.
Yes.
Mr. O'Brien.
I on all items except abstain on M1, 27.
Mrs. Novi?
Yes.
And Dr. King?
Yes, with the exception of standing on M126.
Motion's passed.
Thank you. Any old business? Any general board?
Just general comments? Yeah, I'd like to make two comments. One about what you were just saying. The president was just saying. There are so many things that are going on in my town all the time. Okay, as you said, you know, the Mustangs, the music boosters, and, you know, you go to a football game and you see just the effort that the music booster parents put into making that halftime event. You know, it's amazing. And then you see almost every night of the week you could be going to a meeting in this town. And in the daytime too, like with one Montville play. And I think in keeping with the demographic study, and I think it was helpful information that the mayor gave us about the potential here, that this community has a lot of things going for it that I don't disagree with the demographics, but there's some things we have going for us. We have high parent involvement, we have excellent schools, we have people who are out there volunteering, supporting programs, and we have three interstate highways close to this town, and that's not going to change. And that's another reason why, with all due respect, you know, to the predictions, you never really know, okay? I mean, this is the place to be. You can get to it from here. It really is. We have the great schools, and we have the infrastructure to get in and out of this town. As Charlie was saying before, a lot of people, they move from the big nest into the smaller nest, so they want to stay in the community. So I appreciate what we were told tonight, and not contradicting you or anything, but it's hard to say where we're going with the situation that we have. We're not out in the boondocks. Is boondocks a bad word? Is there anything? But we're a key location. That's the thing about, you know, not just good education, but where we are is where people want to be.
Maybe you should
become
a
realtor.
Okay.
I am a realist, but a realtor is close. Thank you. I just wanted to support what you're saying about this great community.
Thank you. Any other comments?
I just wanted to note that the demographic study, as well as the PowerPoint that Dr. Burke presented this evening, are available on the district website. If you're on the main page, all the way over to the right at the bottom, there's a link that says demographic study, and if you click on that, you can access both those documents.
Can you board comment?
Yes, Charlie, we are.
Just like you remember, rewind all six of you, that the band competition is October 1st at the high school. I know the Tawako Jazz Festival is the same day, but the band competition doesn't start until 4. I also would like to report that I attended the September 11th program over at the VFW building. It was very well attended, and it was very, very, I think Frank Mahalik and the other speakers did an excellent job. Mayor Sandman, his comments are in this week's paper. But all in all, I was proud to represent the board there. And Frank has been doing this. I know many of us know Frank. And he's getting up there, but he's still doing it. We give him a lot of thanks on behalf of the community.
Thanks, Frank. I forgot one more thing. Is there right? Bricks are for sale again. The area outside the high school where the Mustang statue is, bricks are going up for sale for the next round. Notice there's a lot of space there. So get your brick. Right, $7,550 for a big one.
Okay, some of us already have bricks there, Mr. O'Brien.
Yes, some of us do have bricks there.
Yes, I didn't see other names there.
Other people. I just wanted to mention, I was at Lazar back to school night. It seemed to be extremely poor organized. A little bit of traffic on the way in, but the administration really has things under control. Look forward to tomorrow night, the high school back to school night. Renee, I want to thank you for putting pictures of the Hilldale multiple-use court in our packets. Looks beautiful. I look forward to seeing it in person. Incredible job by the Hilldale PTC on that. Karen, look forward to the meeting, the MCBSA meeting. Are they going to be talking about the fair funding formula also, or just real school funding?
I think the conversation can go wherever Morris County School Board members want to take it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
The governor will not be there.
Yeah. And finally, I wanted to thank Mr. O'Brien and Ms. McGraw for volunteering their time as our board liaisons for the 150th anniversary reunion celebration. You'll be working, I'm sure, with members of town council, other members of the community on that. And I'll let Deb Nielsen know.
Only if he promises not to talk as much.
Well, and it should be pointed out that 150th anniversary of the town coincides with the birth of Mr. Brown.
Charlie laughed.
I was going to see that recorded in the paper.
All right, with that, public participation all over the floor. And seeing as there is none, move to adjourn.